what does having the right to vote mean to you?
It's so important that you elect someone that you feel that person can represent you, or that party that you align yourself with, and the things that they stand for, that you agree with them. So really that is, you know, for me is very, very important. And really deciding like who makes a decision for you that can impact on your life. So that's kind of, you know, it's important. I've exercised it, and everybody should exercise their right to vote. And as a woman, I appreciate, you know, what the suffragettes have done for us, the campaign, the sacrifice, what the suffering they had to go for women to have the right to vote. It's a privilege, you know, that in a way that we have to vote. And whenever I do canvassing or I speak to people in Glasgow, I tell them, like, you know, it's important that you exercise your vote, especially to women. And I explain to them about the suffragettes campaign. And I'm like, you know, they fought for us 100 years ago, so you can have a say today. You know, they've sacrificed their lives for this. So we have to remember, you know, our history as a human being, as a woman. We have taken a long route to be here today and to have these privileges. So we should exercise them.
Has this motivated you, this extension of voting rights motivated you to become more politically active here in Scotland?
Yeah. I mean, I believe I have become more active and to encourage ethnic minority communities to know their rights and be aware of politics and what this means for them. Because, you know, this is the first time ever refugees have been given the right to vote. And I think it's historical. And it's first ever to happen in the UK. And Scotland has, you know, shown a strong message that we are a welcoming country. And I think that equality and fairness is already is shown by our government and our Scottish Parliament. I mean, once we got the franchise devolved to Scotland, and Scotland has really have acted to grant, you know, these new powers, it really shows that, you know, we are making a difference for people of ethnic minorities, EU citizens, and young people. They should have the say in our electoral system. So really, I have been very active because I'm very passionate about refugee rights and asylum seekers' rights. And I really welcome the new Scots, and people can actually vote for the first time. I believe that we are a country, it's open and it's inclusive as we can be, and we're building that equal Scotland that we are all new Scots. You and I are part of this country. We are the people that are building this country. So yeah, and I think for me, it's been a really privilege, like speaking to ethnic minorities and encouraging them to vote and, you know, just letting them know about their rights. They were, most of them, you know, they just like, oh, I can vote. Oh my God, I didn't know I can vote. Oh, thank you. So you get that kind of reaction from people. And it's just so like enthusiastic. It energizes your kind of spirit, and you just feel it, that you are making a difference, and people exercising their votes.
Great. I liked so much what you said and how you included me in it too, because I'm very excited to vote. So you talked about it a little bit in the answer to your previous question, but what do you think the barriers might be to different refugee communities who are taking up their right to vote in Scotland? And do you have any advice on how we can overcome that?
Yeah, I think this is a difficult one, because since the consultation happened and the franchise was extended for refugees, I have taken a step personally to make sure that ethnic minority groups or underrepresented people, such as refugees and many of the ethnic minority communities, they don't have barriers, like language barriers has been the main issue. I speak different languages, which is fortunate. I speak Kurdish and Arabic, and I can read and write, and I'm very proud of that. I'm a very multilingual person, and that I have tried to kind of communicate with different communities to make sure that they register. So I have made different meetings over Zoom, actually, to encourage them and illustrated how they can register and to vote and what is their rights, what do they need to have, just making it more simplified for them, because they do find it very difficult, and even like just going online, like they just are not used to it. Practically they don't know how to do it, so you have to really step by step try to take them through the process. But the Electoral Commission, I have to say, they have taken a step as well, and they have provided resources, such as in Arabic, Farsi, and Kurdish, and recently French, because I actually wrote to them, and I have to take credit for this. So I wrote to them and I said, you know, I've spoken with many African communities, and there seems to be the need for them to have French language because, you know, they were colonized by France and, you know, that kind of ties. And, you know, it would be really good to have French language so they know how the process is. So they were actually, they were not aware of that, and they listened to me, and now there's a French language also that within the resource pack. There's been different events organized by the Scottish Refugee Council and many other charities, and they've taken a step forward to encourage and support asylum seekers. And of course, the Scottish National Party, and Kat, I know you've also taken a step. Every Sunday, you try to register people and make sure that they know how to do that. And I think that's been an excellent approach from you, and well done. So I do recognize that.
Thank you.
So thank you for doing that. And really, it's just information. You know, they say information is knowledge. It is, you know, knowledge is power, and information is important. And if they don't have that information, so they can't really exercise that. So we try to kind of, to support them.
So what effect do you think the extended right to vote will have on the next parliament, on the makeup of the next parliament, and Scottish society more broadly, as mm-hmm. we're kind of at a pivotal moment in Scotland's history?
Yeah. So, well, what I think this is an excellent opportunity for, you know, making a difference, to have a parliament to be reflective on the diversity of Scotland, the multicultural Scotland that has, for many years, they've not been represented. And I think this extended right to vote actually raises an awareness of within the communities that, you know, this is a process. And also they would have maybe the opportunity for the future to stand for election. I think this has opened the door for many different communities. And, you know, having the right to vote for the first time, and then having a refugee on top of the list of Glasgow, it really does shows that we are making a difference. You know, in Scotland, we have achieved that, you know, drive for equality and fairness. We've made it, you know, made it possible. And now it's to the electoral actually to vote. So we'll see what happens. But overall, I think the experience of people even voting for the first time will make a huge difference of our inclusivity and diversity. When I was a student, I registered so many students for the referendum and making sure they vote. So I have been doing this for a long time. I mean, I am a new Scot, but I'm also like much more. I don't know if I'm answering this, but I think the main barrier would be for other new Scots, I think, would be language barrier. Because, you know, we have to understand English is not their first language. And it's actually sometimes third language for some new Scots. So we have to understand that, you know, that diversity and, you know, we are a multicultural society.
How do you think being able to vote affects the views on Scottish independence with the refugee community?
Yeah, I think, you know, I've spoken with, as I said, I've organized many events and I'm not just speaking out of the blue. I'm actually speaking for these communities that I have discussed with them and what they think about independence and what it means for them to have an independent country. I mean, we have in our community many barriers, such as getting into employment, recruitment processes, and many feel that they are being discriminated because of their color and they're not getting any job opportunities. That's just one issue. And there are many other issues that, you know, if you've not experienced it, like you don't know how to tackle it and you won't know that this issue actually exists. I think because refugee communities and the EU citizens have been given the opportunity to be here for the first time, I think it will be reflective of what the result will be in May. Building fairness and equality in Scotland will make a difference to these communities, and they will vote for the first time for the Scottish National Party because they believe in independence will make a difference. They have been stuck in this system for far too long, in the immigration system, you know, the cruelty that they have faced, you know, that will be reflective in the electoral voting system.
What advice do you give to people trying to reach out to new voters in their own communities that their neighbors or people they encounter for refugees and asylum seekers? And how can we improve the lines of communication?
I think the best way is forward is that we organize with different communities. Just say, for example, you organize the Kurdish community and then you speak to them. And then you organize the Sudani community, you speak to them. You know, like, I think that's probably best way to communicate. Because of the language barrier, there will be an interpreter and explaining exactly to that community what you're explaining. Because if you have different communities in one meeting, it's very, very difficult to kind of illustrate what you're trying to say, and they're confused and you can't get an interpreter, and now everything's on Zoom, and you know, the kind of extra barrier is being created. So I found it easiest to have meetings with just in like community separately, help them to understand the process, how you register. I've had slides to illustrate to them in pictures what the process looks like when you enter into that link and what is the next step, just step by step and illustration. And I think that's been helpful to the community. Use the resources that's out there and provide that to the community so that information is shared. Try to see there's like who's the community champion and how that can be actually reaching out to the community and be more practical And like pragmatic, yeah. The Electoral Commission has great resources, and the Scottish Refugee Council. And also, there's been from the SNP BME group, we've provided resources and videos as well, so that can be shared with the communities. I would like to say to whoever's like listening to this video and our audience, is that to please encourage like different communities to register and vote is so essential, that they know their rights and they can exercise their rights, and to have a say for the first time. I think that's so important, no matter like what's your political alliance or who you support. I think it's important that you encourage them to register and have their say, because we are in a democratic country.